Welcome to another episode of the Tamil Innovators Spotlight. This is a segment created by tamilculture.com, where we interview people from the global Tamil community who are building really interesting projects, initiatives, and products or services. So my name is Janushika, and I am your host for today. And I'm really excited to introduce you to our special guest, Nivatha Balendra. So Nivatha, thank you so much for coming today. Big warm welcome onto the show.
Thanks for having me. Really happy to be here.
Yeah, no problem. So just a little bit about Nivatha. Nivatha's story is just so interesting. I was telling her earlier that I'm just so in awe of her story because it started at such an incredibly young age. So just for the audience, I'll walk you a little bit through Nivatha's story. And it actually began at the age of 17, where she began to research and get really interested in oil degrading bacteria. So from there, she actually started going from looking at research to conducting her own research. And it literally began in her own backyard. She got some soil samples and also went to the St. Lawrence River. And she was actually able to discover a very new type or strain of bacteria that's able to degrade oil in an eco-friendly way. So this was just a huge like revelation. And because of this, she was actually able to get the bacteria named after her. Now, due to her research or because of her research efforts, she was awarded the inaugural World Economic Forum Prize at the Intel International Science and Tech Fair, where she was one of the youngest recipients to be invited to the event, which is just incredible. In addition to this, she's been recipient to numerous awards, which are including not limited to Canada's Top 20 Under 20 by Plan Canada, as well as Corporate Knights Top 30 Under 30. And kind of like aside from the business and entrepreneurial aspect of her life, Nivatha is also a cancer survivor. And this experience for her kind of introduced her to the significance and importance of non-toxic, sustainable ingredients, which kind of embarked her on this personal mission to make sustainable ingredients more possible and more accessible. So yeah, that's kind of like her rap sheet, but I'm going to pass the mic to Nivatha and kind of ask her, can you kind of tell the audience what a little bit about yourself and your family and your upbringing?
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, thanks for that. Really, really appreciate it. So a bit about my upbringing background from where I was from, right? So I'm born in Montreal, Quebec, Sri Lankan Tamil. Obviously, I was born here in Canada, but my parents are from Sri Lanka. And I mean, a typical day in our household growing up was for me really just tinkering around with different things. I was just someone as a kid who was really curious. And I had parents who encouraged that fully. I mean, they never really boxed me into something specific, and they would see that I was interested in something particular, they would, you know, encourage me to go for it. And I think especially as I grew older, they saw that I was really passionate about sciences and research. And, you know, when I was a kid, I would present certain topics to my family at the dinner table. And, you know, that was just sort of the childhood that I had. And they were always, you know, sitting down after dinner and listening to that. So growing up in that type of environment really, yeah, I guess, encouraged me to follow the type of aspirations that I wanted to have. And my mom especially was someone who was, you know, completely devoted to community service. So she worked at the South Asian Women's Community Center, and she always instilled in my brother and myself the importance of helping society. You know, no matter what it is that you do, you have to help society. And so naturally for me, because I love sciences, that was sort of the outlet that I use. And I thought, you know, well, there's so much that can be solved using science. And I guess I took that with me wherever I went.
Yeah. Yeah. When I heard your story, I was like, man, I don't know what your parents did, but they must have done something right. Definitely. So you mentioned that you're always interested in the sciences. So what I think is really remarkable about your story is really that it started so young, and you kind of mentioned like it was always from an early age. So the story I know is like it started at 17. For me, like a lot of 17-year-olds are not, you know, conducting their own research and like really trying to solve big world issues. So I really want to know, can you walk me through kind of like your 17-year-old self, and what about this issue really inspired you to, you know, take it further, take it to the next step and conduct your own research?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, for me, I think that really started with high school. I, like I mentioned, was someone who was interested in different things, lots of different things, but I was always experimenting, I guess, with different projects, different ideas, and I had a family who really encouraged that. For me personally, in high school was when I started science fairs. It was also mandatory in school to some level, but at the grade 8, it was only mandatory later on, but I guess I and a couple of friends started doing science fairs early on, starting in grade 8. And through that, I thought it was just really cool that we can, as a kid, have real life lab experience. And I didn't know if I liked it or not. I never, you know, stepped foot into a lab, but I thought, you know, why not take this as an opportunity to learn more about different fields? So I guess science fair is really what was the catalyst for me. Provided me with this outlet to explore this curious nature of mine and implement it into focusing on real life problems. So as I grew every year, I just focused on that. And in CEJA, pre-university, I guess it would be equivalent to grade 12 and 13 outside of Quebec. That was when I did my last science fair project, which was focused on these oil degrading bacteria and their capacity in remediating oil contamination. And that really sprouted from a train crash that happened in 2013 in Quebec. There was actually that happened in a rural town called Lac Mégantic, and over 5 million gallons of oil were spilled. And it's one thing to hear about oil spills, you know, across from you, somewhere around the world, but when it happens within reach, it kind of puts environmental problems, especially into context, because it really is a global issue. And I think learning more about that is when I thought, oh, well, why don't I couple, you know, environmental microbiology, which I learned in a previous internship the previous year, and how these microbes produce soapy compounds, and see whether that can be implemented in a sustainable solution for oil spills. And so that's really how it started evolving and eventually turned into Dispersa that it is today.
That's incredible. So this was actually from a science fair project.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. So I guess I'm curious, like, how did you even know what to do, like what the process was? Because I understand like reading about the research is different from actually trying to take it into your own hands and do it yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, because I started science fairs in grade 8, since then I did sort of different topics. I believe in grade 9, 10, 11-ish, I was focused more on projects involving microbiology and immunology, and I started gaining more lab experience that way. And of course, I didn't know what I was doing at first. There were mentors, and they were PhD students or PhD grads who would welcome students into their lab. And so I had a specific project. We applied through this platform, you know, emailing the students, and then they matched us, and then we had this opportunity to work in their labs and learn cool lab techniques. And I thought, you know what, you know, this is pretty cool, like I like it, but I'm still a kid and I'm still figuring out what I like and what I don't like. And I guess as I grew older, that really stuck with me. And it was something that I realized I was passionate about, which was research, more specifically using research for purposeful things and that things that can help society. So in CEGEP, things were a bit different because we were in a different age group. I had to reach out directly to professors to ask if they would be willing to have me in their lab. So I basically prepared a project plan saying what it is that I want to achieve, which was using environmental microbiology. I spoke more about details about biosurfactants, which is a type of soapy compound that can be used to degrade oil particles. And I highlighted, you know, like a whole experimental plan, you know, hypothesis, objectives, materials, etc. And I sent it to about 60 professors across Quebec who are specialized in this field of microbiology. And I said, you know, I have a science group project coming up. I would really appreciate the chance to work in your lab for this amount of time to execute this project under the guidance of you or your student. And obviously there's a lot of professors who are super supportive of this type of venture, but not everyone has the resources for it either. So I did get a lot of no's, but I got one yes. So that was enough for me. I got one yes from a professor in Laval who said, you know, definitely up his alley and aligned with what he works on. And so he welcomed me in his lab and I started working there. And what I really appreciated was the amount of autonomy and independence he gave me. He treated me like his own student. And mind you, there were only master's or PhD students there. So I learned a lot from them. And they were there as mentors, you know, both shadowing. And I would be able to ask questions and really learn from them. And that's really the most amount of learning that I did was really hands-on and learning from others. So that's basically how the project evolved. And that professor who allowed me into his lab, his name is Eric Desiel, and he is currently still with me in this adventure at Dispersa. So I continued that mentorship, and he's played a really big role in my career trajectory.
Wow. Okay. So that's really interesting. So you said that you had, or you sent out approximately 60 applications and only one of them was accepted?
Yeah, exactly. It was a lot of, a lot of professors were super encouraging. I mean, they would love students, but not everyone has the resources or the authority to have, you know, underage at that time. I was 17. So having those under 18 in their lives. So there's a lot of restrictions, but I got one yes. So that was really all that I needed in order to execute the project.
That's all you need. How did you handle like kind of the rejection? Like, did it get you discouraged or like, how'd you kind of overcome that?
Yeah, I guess I was, but looking back, 17 is a long time ago. I'm thinking back. I think for me, I was focused on getting the one yes. I knew before going in that there would be many rejections and that this was a far shot, but I prepared myself for that. And I think personally, I didn't really care about all the no's because I knew that I sent out emails. So every time there was a no, I just, you know, strike that and said, okay, well, there's 59 more, you know, and I just kept going through that list. And until I was concerned, you know, what if no one says yes, then I wouldn't be able to conduct this project because I do need a lab to do that. But yeah, I was hopeful and I kept working through that list.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm really curious, like you have a huge life accomplishment. I mean, you've accomplished a lot more than many people lifetime at a really young age, right? And one of those achievements is discovering a new strain of bacteria and having it named after you. Can you kind of walk me through the feeling or the moment where you realized that you made a discovery and what that experience or emotion was like?
Yeah, it's really sweet of you. Definitely not. I have many more years ahead and many more things to learn. But yeah, I guess the experience of the research that was part of the Science Group project, what it started off was the purpose was not to find microbes. It was not to find a novel strain, or the real purpose was, how could we use these tiny microbes that we can't even see with our eyes? They produce these soapy compounds, which I thought was insane. I'm like, how is this thing that we don't see producing things externally that we can use in real life? It just it blew my mind, because I can't even see it with my eyes when it's producing it. I need to put under a microscope, or I need to actually produce it in a batch. And so that's really what motivated me to go that stream. And the objective of that project was really to identify local strains in Quebec, in Montreal specifically, that can produce this molecule that I called, that I mentioned, biosurfactants. So I basically went, like you said, to my backyard. It was the easiest place to get soil, right? And these microbes are found in soil culture. So I went to my backyard, got some soil samples, went near the St. Lawrence River, got a few other samples. And then I basically came into the lab with bags of soil and then creating different dilutions and basically investigating the various microbial cultures that are in those soil samples. And as I was doing that, I found what I was looking for, which was different types of microbes producing that compound that I mentioned. But I brought in my mentor, Eric Desiel, and he took a look at the strains and he said, can you do like this specific test, basically? And so I did that test and I showed him the results, and he said, you know what, that's actually really interesting. We haven't seen something like that before. And clearly for me, I'm still learning. So I learned a lot from him, who is the expert in this field. And so we decided that it would be worthwhile to look into the genetic code of these microbes, which we did through a partnership with McGill. And then through that, we saw that there was actually a lot of differences in this particular bacteria than the other ones that I was aiming for. And that's really what ended up in that type of discovery. And it was not at all what I was expecting from the start, and not the purpose either after the project, but it was still a cool thing.
Okay, so it was like an accidental kind of discovery?
Yeah, exactly. It was not purposeful at all. Really, the main point was I wanted to find strains that were producing this compound, and it so happened that one of the strains that were producing it that I isolated from the soil samples were presenting with novel properties that we normally don't expect of these types of microbes. And so that really not only intrigued me, but I think what intrigued me the most was my mentor, the professor who's been in this field for years, was super intrigued by it. So generally when your mentor is intrigued by something, then you're also really excited about it. So I think that's really what inspired me to continue the research too, was seeing that there was a lot of potential in this type of research, and that's what I continued over years.
Yeah, that must have been like a really proud moment for yourself and your family. And it kind of makes me wonder, like, who did you have on your support team? Who were kind of like your mentors and the people that were supporting you, like at this stage of your journey?
Definitely, for sure, hands down, my family has always been there, backing me up. And like I mentioned, my mentor, the professor, and of course the student, the PhD students, I had two in particular that were basically supervising or being present at the early stages. And then near the end, really handed me that autonomy. And I think being handed that responsibility at an early age made me feel autonomous and trusted and kind of a vote of confidence, like, yeah, I can do it too. And I think that's really what motivated me to learn more. So, I mean, all in all, I had support from my personal side, but also on the professional side. And I think having that mixed together really helped me thrive in the direction that I wanted to go personally. And, you know, I really can't thank my family enough, particularly my parents. My dad was the one, as I was a kid, driving me back and forth to the labs. And this was like a 40-minute drive from Montreal back and forth. So it was like 2 hours almost, but he was, oh, wow. He was just like really, really committed. So, you know, after work, he would say, you know, send me your lab schedule. I'm going to bring you there and I'm going to bring you back. And, you know, you have to do this. It's for school. And also he saw that it was something I was really interested in. So he was naturally interested in that as well. And so he brought me everywhere. And similarly, my mom was always there as a moral support, as well as, you know, if I wanted to present something and I wanted to show her my results, she would sit patiently and learn more about my research. And that level of genuine interest and encouragement is what was really the most important piece of my childhood growing up.
Yeah, I think I saw you in a TED talk where you're talking about your dad and how the both of you would actually dig up soil together at the St. Lawrence River.
Yeah, exactly. So my dad, if I can say, he's been kind of a sidekick in this entire journey, indirectly, and my mom as well. And my dad was the one driving us mostly. So he was the one more directly involved with, you know, bringing me to the lab or going to pick up samples. And so, yeah, that was at the St. Lawrence River. So he came with me and, you know, I told him, like, this is the area that we need to look at for soil. We had our shovels and, you know, we started digging and collecting those soil samples. So they were both really always there for me.
That's fantastic. Do your parents come from like a science background, or like, did you have anyone else that like kind of inspired you to like enter like the science field? Do you have any siblings too?
Yeah, I have an older brother. So looking at it from my parents' background, so my mom comes from a completely non-science background. She and my dad, when they immigrated over here, she went straight into community service. And so while she wished to have become a scientist, if the situation had permitted, that would have been what she would have pursued. But for her, it was community service is really at the heart of it, and, you know, helping people. So she found her nest, if you will, within the South Asian Women's Community Center. For my dad, he does have an architectural background. And so he finished his architecture degree, came here, and then worked as an architect, but then transitioned into real estate. So while not exactly the type of science background, still somewhat of an engineer at heart. So that mindset from both of them, despite that, and despite it not being a field that they were particularly knowledgeable on, they knew that their daughter was really interested in it. And I think that that's really what motivated them, even if they didn't understand everything, to still provide me with the opportunities that I needed to grow.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so what I want to kind of ask you about next is, okay, so you discovered this new strain of bacteria. And then because of that, you got invited to the Intel International Science Tech Fair, where you were awarded that award that I mentioned earlier. So can you kind of let me know like what that experience was like? I know that the event was in China, so it's kind of like a really far away from home for you. and just kind of walk me through your experience and your emotions kind of going through.
Yeah, for sure. I guess it was a bit of a nerd goal of mine to get into the Intel for from a long time, because I was doing science fairs every year too. And the final year I had the opportunity to go, and that was in Cali. It was really nice. And I think the most rewarding part was seeing other students. So these are students from all over the world, basically. So basically every country you can imagine just congregated in this one place. And we're all there because we have different science for projects, and we're there sharing our results, and we're sharing our passion for science. And you know, that how that experience was is, and what the fair was, is a competition. And it's a competition where, you know, students that are selected from their respective countries go and they present. It's sort of like the Olympics of pre-university science, if you will, which was really cool because you get to see different types of research and learn about different topics, but also make lifelong bonds and friendships. And so I'm still in touch with some friends that I made through science fair to this day as well. And from science fair, what I got the opportunity of experiencing was going to China through the World Economic Forum. And that was a really, really nice experience. I think just visiting China on its own for me at that age, I was super excited about that. I went with my dad, actually. So I think for them, they're, you know, okay, I don't know if we want to send you all the way across the world, especially because, you know, yeah. I don't know the culture, I don't know the language, and there would be a significant amount of time that we would have to spend alone in China. So my dad came with me, and we did make a trip out of it. So that was nice. I think we had the forum, which was incredible. I think myself and three others were selected from the fair to go. And so all four of us formed this type of group. And we were at the forum. We attended many different workshops and presentations. And these are, you know, world leaders from different countries. I mean, there were political leaders there. There were industry experts there. They all congregate at the World Economic Forum on a yearly basis to tackle the most pressing issues around the globe. And to know that I was in their presence was just really humbling and a real great honor. It also provided me with the opportunity to share my research, to get feedback on, you know, different ways of growing that. And coming out of that experience is what was a catalyst, I would say, for me to say, you know what, I think that the industry experts that I spoke with at this conference especially were encouraging me to transform this into a real life solution, and motivated me into knowing that there can be a real application out of the science fair project. And so I took that with me back home and started continuing working on that.
So, like, what's really interesting to me is that you accomplished so much so young. And like, I'm wondering, when you went to this fair where there were so many prominent individuals talking about important world issues, did you ever struggle with like imposter syndrome? Like, did you ever feel that kind of the strain of that at all?
Yeah, I mean, imposter syndrome is one of those things that just it comes, right? And it's inevitable. I do feel that it is something that comes in phases, especially as we're trying new things. And I think that's what I've come to learn right now. Definitely when I went to science fair, I think not only it being my first time, I'm surrounded by so many other kids, but I think what overshadowed all of that nervousness maybe was the fact that, like, it's just so exciting, and I was more focused on that and the like how fun the actual trip was and being there. I mean, we didn't only do the fair, we went and we explored Cali, we did a bunch of other things. And so I'm someone who loves traveling as a result, and I think that really was encouraged through the various traveling that I had to do at science fair. But imposter syndrome is real. And I think that it can come at many different phases as a kid, as we are now, as we're older. And what I've come to realize, and of course, like, this is just purely my own views and opinion, is it comes as we're taking risks, right? We might be the only person in the room that looks like us. We might be the only woman in the room. We might be the only Tamil person in the room. That was often the case for me. And I think that contributes a lot to imposter syndrome, is there's no one else that looks like me in the room, right? And I think that in a way became my motivation, is I know that I'm currently the only person that looks like me in the room at the time, but I want to change that, and I want to make it a safe space for future kids, future Tamil kids, to know that, you know, they don't need to feel isolated, or they don't need to feel that it's something that they can't get into. Like, I don't want that nervousness, that anxiety to exist, you know. And I think that there is a bunch of amazing Tamil professionals like you, like, that are doing great things, and I think that we're all contributing to that, is like making the future generation of Tamil kids, both boys and girls, feeling welcomed and feeling like they have a space, and that they can take up space, and that they can do so and succeed in their lives.
Yeah, definitely. I think there's something about, like, you know, feeling the fear and doing it anyways. And it reminds me of a quote I read, which is, once you become fearless, your life really becomes limitless. And it's an amazing quote. And it kind of, you know, reminds me of you, like, you've done a lot. But yeah, I mean, I guess it's just about powering through the fear and kind of doing it anyways, because if it doesn't challenge you, it's really not going to change you. So yeah, I want to actually kind of transition into kind of your entrepreneurial life and the business aspect. So you're the CEO and founder of CleanTech company Dispersa. Can you kind of tell the audience what exactly Dispersa does and how you kind of created the company?
Yeah, absolutely. So Dispersa sprouted from that science group project, right? And it didn't happen in a linear fashion at all. So and that's another important point that I want to stress, is like, everyone has their own pathways and then different ways of getting to point B or C or D. But for me, how my journey was I, after doing that science fair, coming back from China, continuing that research, and I had an idea to start a company. And that was maybe around age 19, 20. And I thought, like, how cool would it be if we actually formalize this into a company? Obviously, I had no clue as to how to do that. None of my parents were particularly experienced in that field either. And obviously, it takes a lot of resources. We need funding. We need equipment. We need a lab. There's so many things in order to formalize that into an actual company. And so it was always like an idea at the back of my head, but I knew that I wanted to do it. And I was starting to plan how the company would be. I didn't have like a company name or anything in mind at that time. But then that was when I was diagnosed with cancer. And so that put a halt to all of those activities. And I think that was a really hard moment in my life, where I was so excited to get this up and running, and then hitting that roadblock, and then not only putting that aside, but not knowing if, you know, I'm going to be alive in a few weeks or months. And my focus became my health, and that's really what took over the time after I was diagnosed with cancer. So I went through intensive chemotherapy, and then later in that year as well, unfortunately, my mom passed away. And so all of that culminating in the year really provided me with a lot of perspective that, you know what, life is short. If there's something that you want to do right now, this is your chance. This is the one life that you get. And that's really what I took out of that experience. And I made a promise to myself that, you know, you wanted to start a company before you got cancer, you're going to start it. And so that's really what I took with me after I went back to school, I studied at McGill. And so I went back to school after I was done my treatment, and I got this opportunity in the form of the Women in CleanTech Challenge that was presented to me. And it was funny enough, my dad, who actually shared this with me. So I was just in my room working on my homework, and my dad comes in and he says, "Hey, Nivatha, there's this newsletter that I got. There's something called the Women in CleanTech Challenge. I'm not sure about it, but I know you've always wanted to start a company and it seems like it's supported by the federal government. Maybe take a look." And I was like, yeah, I'll take a look. I didn't really think about it at first. I was just like so focused on like exams and getting things done for school. But I took a look at it and I thought, you know, this actually seems super cool. Like the whole premise of the Women in CleanTech Challenge is to support the selected finalists over a 2-year period by providing them with funding, business support, lab access, basically everything they need to transform their idea in sustainability to a profitable business. And I thought that really spoke to me. That's exactly what I want to do. And that's exactly what I was lacking. So I'm not going to lose anything by submitting an application. So I submitted the application, and then I was selected for the subsequent rounds, and we had a live pitch at the Mars Discovery District incubator in Toronto, and that was the first business pitch that I did. Obviously up until then I was always science fair pitches, which I've come to learn are very different from business pitches. So no, it's I was there more like talking about science and how science is cool, but it was a really nice experience. And at the end of it, I was selected as one of the 6 finalists for the program, which quite frankly, culminated into everything that I was working on before that, right? And this, I was like, wow, okay, this is the moment to make that promise to myself come true. And I'm going to make that company come to life. And that is what Dispersa is today.
Yeah. So I saw that you got selected as one of the top 6 finalists. And I believe it was a 30-month kind of accelerator program, right?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. It was supposed to be 2 years and then extended with the pandemic. And I mean, they even throughout the pandemic continue to support us. So they extended the program.
Okay. So in that kind of accelerator program, you had funding from the government, you had support from the Mars kind of incubator and their mentorship. And I believe that you were competing for a $1 million prize, right, for your company?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So that seems like really intense and higher, and I honestly can't even imagine how that feels like, but kind of seems like a dream come true too. Can you tell me a little bit about that experience and what your journey was like within the 30 month, or I know it was extended, but that period of time in that competing period?
Absolutely. I mean, I was just over the moon really, because I was more focused on the fact that I get to create a company and it's financially supported than the competition. I know it's a competition, but as time went, all of the women in clean tech, we were 6. We formed a really close bond. I mean, we created a WhatsApp group. We kept in touch with each other because a lot of the challenges that we were facing were so similar. And so we were able to help each other. So as time went, it didn't really seem like a competition. It just felt like a cohort, a group, and that we were there for each other, and that Mars and the federal government were generously supporting us in building out our companies. So a few lessons from that for me were really focus on business development, learning more business acumen, also understanding how to create and fund a company. And so there were a lot of steps involved from beginning until end. So looking at it from a technology point of view, there are items called, you know, value proposition, your product market fit. Does anyone want your technology? Is it needed in the market? Are there customers? Who are the customer groups? And then how are you going to pitch that to investors? What does the legal structure of your company look like? How are you going to finance it through private and public funds? And then also supporting us in creating a solid network within the Canadian and US clean tech ecosystem as well, to help us have those conversations as we grow our company. And so even though we were in this competition, a really long period of competition, there were a lot of support that was provided in that time. And for me, the real prize was that, you know, the $1 million would have been the cherry on the top, but the real prize is that experience. And each year that they, that we continued on in the incubator program, there were a generous amount of funds still being pulled into our company. So not only through Mars, but over the last years of running Dispersa, I've also secured with my team generous support from provincial and other federal entities as well. And so to date, we've already been funded over $1.5 million. And right now we're in our investment round of $2 million. And so we're on track to securing that next tranche of funding.
That's incredible. You surprised me over and over again, honestly. But yeah, that's amazing. So, you know, you've mentioned like the progress of your company. Where do you kind of see Dispersa going in the next 5 years?
Yeah, that's a heavy question. I see a lot of things. We have, you know, our five-year roadmap. We want to grow big. We want to grow fast. We want our ingredients to be available to end users in as many industries as possible. Right now, we're focusing on consumer goods. So right now, what we're focusing on is, within that, developing partnerships with end users who make products that we use each day. For example, right now, we're working with the two clients in the cleaning product sector. So what's really neat is the ingredients that our microbes produce are currently going to be integrated into real life products. And those are going to be available on the market. And so we're going to be working with similar customers. And that's where our fundraising is going towards right now, is investing and financing in our scale up so that we can produce more materials, because there's a lot of demand that we're having right now. A lot of clients that see that having sustainable ingredients is even more important right now, as consumers are becoming more aware and demanding more transparency in the products that they use. So we do have big brand names as well that we likely use on a daily basis as well, that we look forward to partnering. And so what we look forward to over the 5 years is especially that, is seeing our ingredients and products, and for people to pick that up from a grocery store and say, well, you know, this product contains Dispersa's biosurfactants, and we know that it's more sustainable than it was before. And that's really the job done for us.
Yeah. Yeah. That's amazing. Sorry, I'm just like at the time here. And honestly, time just flew by just talking to you. And I realized we're actually almost out of time. So I'm going to have to fast forward to some of the concluding questions. But I just wanted to kind of ask you, like, you've had a lot of life experience, and you've overcome many, many challenges. So can you tell us about kind of some of the lessons that you've learned along the way? just kind of looking back, thinking about the obstacles you overcame and how much you've accomplished to date?
I definitely have more learnings ahead of me, and I'm definitely not someone who knows all of it, but I can mm-hmm. share a bit from my personal experiences and what I've learned and what has helped me. I think first and foremost is being relentless. If there is something that you really want in life, realizing that this is literally your only chance to do that and to make it happen, and sticking to it. If you don't feel that it's something that you can stick to in the long term, it's likely not your passion. So definitely mm-hmm. go out and find what it is that you're passionate about. I think in line with that is also ensuring that you have that determination to deal with those no's. It is hard. I would say the percentage of no's outweighs the yeses, and that's just the natural evolution of things. But what's great, and I think what I've come to realize as well, is that the more no's I get, I know that there's a yes that's coming soon, you know. And so I think just focusing energy on that positive side of things, it is hard. Not to say some days will be harder than others, but having that positivity and determination to still get up and say, you know what, today was a really, really bad day. I did not go as planned, but tomorrow I'm going to try to make it work. And really just envisioning what it is that you want your life to be and keep working at it.
And what kind of kept you going through the times where, you know, like you were going through a day and you're like, yeah, this is what I planned. Things are not kind of going as I expected. I'm not feeling too great about that. Like, how did you kind of get through that when you're not feeling as motivated?
Yeah, I mean, for sure. There have been many days like that. It's definitely not all rainbows and sunshines. And there is a lot of days, especially as an entrepreneur, when you're faced with difficult decisions and also uncertainty. I think for me the biggest life lesson was through my experience with cancer. I think I always revert back to that, and I think, well, yeah, that was a period of uncertainty that I had. I didn't know if I would make it out alive or not, and I did. I was lucky enough to make it through that experience. But any day that I have that is filled with uncertainty or a bad day, quote unquote, is uncomparable to, you know, that period in my life. And so I think putting things into perspective, not only to yourself, but just in the general scheme of things, and saying that, you know, there is a lot of things going on around the world right now. Is this really as bad as it seemed? Or could I turn it around? And could I turn it around and make it work in my favor? And I think that's really the type of mindset that I started adopting. And there's always a way to make something better out of something that was worse. And it's just a matter of mindset. Obviously better, it's easier said than done, for sure, but it's something that comes with years, comes with going through that experience and really just working at it.
Yeah, I mean, I can't imagine, you know, what going through cancer must have been like, but seems like a really kind of life-changing experience. And it seems like you've gotten a lot of good perspective from it. And I like what you said about, you know, is this really as bad as it seems? Because sometimes we can make these problems so big in our heads, right? So it's exactly. It's really good perspective. Yeah.
Yeah, it's exactly like that. I mean, I think it's, we're often our worst critics, and we might be hard on ourselves, right? And so when something doesn't work out, we're quick to say, oh my God, like, why didn't it work? It's terrible, and we start feeling worse about the situation. But I think if we kind of just step aside and kind of, like, if I can say, remove ourselves from that and then take a look at things objectively, it helps to have a clear mind space into, okay, what am I going to be doing next? So I guess what I'm trying to say is, time spent worrying, or the time spent basically mulling out this bad day, is better spent instead jumping back, if they have the energy, into doing something that is more productive and will help, you know, what it is that you're working towards.
Yeah, thank you so much for sharing that. As a final question for you, what advice would you give to the Tamil community, STEM students, or really anybody else that is interested in following your footsteps?
For sure. Well, like I said earlier as well, I think that all of us have different journeys. So I really hope that the future generation and everyone really just find their own way of doing things. For me, this was my journey, and my journey may be completely different from someone else's, and it doesn't make it any more or less appealing, so to speak. I think it's that, you know, really focusing on what it is that your passion is working towards. And like we mentioned earlier, imposter syndrome is something that is real. But surrounding yourself with the support system, and if you don't have a support system that is readily accessible, creating a network. I can't stress the importance of networking even earlier on. Don't feel that you're too young to start networking, and don't feel shy. It's natural to feel shy. It's natural to feel, you know, maybe I should wait until I'm a PhD to start networking. But honestly, that is not necessary. Start making connections. Start meeting people who align with what you want, and they will be your support system, and they will help you get there. So I think if I were to share any piece of advice, is surrounding yourselves with a solid network, getting to know people, and also working relentlessly, and most importantly, believing in yourself and knowing that it is that you can do it, and also knowing that you can reach out to other Tamil men and women in your community. For example, you know, if anyone listening to this right now wants to reach out to me, I'm more than happy to have a chat with you, and you know, to connect you with someone that I may know. And similarly, if they wanted to connect with anyone else in the community, is knowing that we are there to help the future generation, and that is part of our responsibility, right? As the current, I wouldn't say older generation, but you know what I mean. So we're
it's a slippery slope.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, what's the right word? But the generation right now, I mean, like, we're, and even our parents, we're all there, is all I'm trying to say, is that we have a solid community of Tamil professionals as well, upcoming and current as well, that are there to help the future generations. And I think that it's definitely our responsibility as well to make sure that future Tamil children have that confidence, as well as the encouragement that they need to form those ties, and to know that they can succeed in anything that they want to succeed in.
Nivatha, I can't speak to, like, how much I'm honestly in awe of your story. You inspire me so much, and I'm sure you're inspiring everyone who's listening. So thank you so much for being a guest on the Tamil Innovator Spotlight. Really, really appreciate it.
Thank you. It's very sweet of you, but I'm always here, and if anyone wants to reach out,